be a successful in your trip to your destination. Otherwise, things can go wrong. And in fact, this is a very strong statement made by Sam Harris here, that if you fail to prepare, you are surely planning for a failure. So, nobody less than Warren Buffett says that it is impossible to unsign a contract, so that you have to do your thinking, all the thinking before you sign. Because once you sign, you freeze all the terms and conditions. And all the parties involved in the contract get associated with the terms and conditions. And after signature, it becomes a very, very sensitive issue and a strong ground for disputes. That's why I mentioned that all sorts of planning has to be done very much in advance before the contract is done. We all know in government organizations, when we go in for contracts, there are lots of weaknesses in our planning. Many a times, we hardly have any time to even plan for the floating of tenders. And as we see, once the tenders are floated, once again, lethargy comes in, both sides, from our side as well as from the tenderer side. They don't read all the terms and conditions, and then we go ahead finalizing tenders and then get into problems. Things are getting more sensitive by the day. So it is important that all of us appreciate the need for proper contract management. I have been introduced. I have a post-graduation in construction management followed by an MBA in IIM Bangalore. Of course, I am an engineer in civil engineering. I am a specialist in systems, especially procurement systems, and more particularly public procurement systems, which I have dealt in World Bank tenders also, as well as GFADM is there, another body which is a multinational development bank. And of course, I have been greatly associated with Government of India funds. Wherein procurements here, remember, not unlike in railways, in many of the international organizations, procurements include not only goods and services, but also works. That is, our engineering contracts are also part and parcel of procurements, and senior procurement specialists only do that. And what are CNNC, that is services or consulting services and non-consulting services, which you all can understand. Consulting is of a very specialized nature. Non-consulting is like your transport services or hiring of vehicles or hiring of cleaning people. These are all routine works. So they are all non-consultant, and consulting is of specialist. Further, I am being a system specialist. You know, my interest is in ISO 9000, that is quality management system, engineering management systems, and TQMs. So with all this background, let us now move forward to understanding a contract. Of course, the main elements of a contract has to have an offer, an acceptance, a consideration, that is a step for when the exchange of goods, services or money takes place as stipulated in the contract. With the contract, both the parties will want something. So this element is to be, one party is trading for one another their rights as well as their responsibilities and duties. So it has got a consideration amount, which is there in a contract. In an agreement, there need not be a consideration. We will look into that. Of course, here meeting of minds is very important. Both the parties should be sound in their mind and understanding the terms and conditions.
Recording in progress.
Sorry. The contract has to be enforceable by law. So for that, the contents must be legal in nature. And also, the location should be very clear, so that arbitration and court cases, the legal dispute resolution, the forum has to be very clearly decided in the contract. In the terms of the contract, maybe it is expressly indicated or subtly indicated, but then it should form part of the contract. Of course, the capacity is to determine the mental age of the party who is associated, the mental condition, and even whether he is legally entitled to take a contract, because if he is in a bail, many a times he is not entitled to get into a contract, so it also matters that way. Now, to understand how an agreement, normal agreement, is different from a contract, especially when it is not a contract, because all contracts are agreements, but not necessarily that all agreements are contracts. So, which are those cases which are not enforceable by law? There may not be any consideration, because consideration is not a compulsory for an agreement, and many of these agreements are unwritten. Only when we go in for contracts, they become legally enforceable by law. Many of the MOUs and letter of intents, they don't constitute agreements. Not the LOA which we issue after a tender is finalized, but some letter of intents are MOUs are generally an agreement between parties that how they will set forth their planning for concluding some contracts. Only based on the MOUs and LOIs, contract can be concluded at a later date. It is something like our framework contracts or rate contracts, wherein as such a rate contract does not become a contract till a purchase order or a supply order, as we normally call it, is concluded. There are many domestic agreements between family members, like a husband, wife, brothers and all that, and friends also. They all need not be contracts. Social agreements wherein like in a journalist and a businessman can go hand in glove. I scratch your back, you scratch my back. They can have a subtle understanding, which we see nowadays. There is no free press. There is no free journalism. There are no free social media. Many of the times they are fake newses or biased newses. So these are all social agreements which may be legal, which may not be legal also. Similarly, casual agreements which are mostly verbal among friends or some parties, many are, especially when they are illegal in nature, these are all casual agreements. They are agreements, they have sanctity among themselves, but cannot be enforced by law. Let us understand this as in the form of an example. As we go, we will be giving lot of examples because many of the things of contracts are known to people. But where a contract can get into a dispute and where sensitivities are associated in a contract needs to be understood. I have put in lot of examples here because generally these sessions go for about 10 hours, a total package, but I am compressing it into 1.5 hour session, so I am falling short of time. So I want to give only examples for your immediate understanding and consumption. A person A agrees to sell his house to a person B for rupees 50 lakhs. So this is an example of, is it a contract or is it an agreement, or it is neither agreement nor a contract, or is it a contract as soon as A gets the money for it? The answer here is it is neither a contract nor an agreement, because there is no way B is involved in this picture. The only thing A is deciding on himself, he is agreeing for selling it, he has fixed the date, but B is nowhere in the picture. So even if later on somebody gives the money on behalf of B to A, as long as the legality is not there, it neither becomes a contract nor an agreement. Consequential damages. Are defendants liable to pay? I mean, is anybody liable to pay damages suffered by any other party? Okay, when the party is directly not associated for or responsible for the loss. Especially we see this in our railway system. We purchase lot of small items like bolts, nuts and any components. And if a full loco which is waiting for POH is waiting for this component, we railways have to bear lot of losses in terms of damages or loss of revenue by holding the loco or the coach for want of that spare. Can we hold that supplier responsible? If they are responsible, to what extent? That is the issue for discussion here. There is a case of Adley and Baxendale. Adley is a big company which in the 1854, which was powered by a steam engine, which was the source of their energy. And the crankshaft of the steam engine had conked off and broken. So that had to be replaced. So they entered into a transport contract with Baxendale, and they asked them to hand over to the place where it did get repaired, and then again bring it back and hand over back the, this is the contract conditions. But there has been unreasonable delay, of course partly responsible by the transporter also, and the factory had to be shut down unwarrantedly because of the failure of this transport contractor. So how do we understand this? The damages to which a non-breaching party is entitled fairly and reasonably are those arising naturally from the breach itself, or those that are in reasonable contemplation of the party. So the transport contractor, he may not be party to the total manufacturing process of the company. His terms of conditions are only to transport and bring it back. So to the extent of the losses that are directly associated because of him, that only can be charged or levied or imposed. But you cannot levy the complete expenses of a shutdown cost of the company Hadley, which they had not taken them to court. It is called remoteness of damages against any breach of contract. The liability of all losses shall be foreseen based on information available to the party in breach. So basically, it is good to have a proper discussion and understanding between the parties as to what the repercussions are. Generally, even though if it is not contractually binding, but at least it should be communicated well so that each can emulate or empathize on the other situation and try to go the extra mile for delivering a proper job. Of course, the damages can be predetermined in the contract itself very well. Even if it is going to be extraordinary high predetermined damages, it can be put in the contract, and in case the tenderer or the participant who is offering the services is willing to bear those type of predetermined damages, then it is in order. So these type of things can come into a disputed arena. Can offers be open to public in general and lead to a contract? Like in newspaper advertisements, there are a lot of things. We float tenders, a lot of alliances, matrimonials are coming. So can be treated as offers by itself. There's an interesting case of yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. It's frequently getting muted. Yeah. A company in 1990 advertises for a prescription drug. It was in the same situation as what we are in now. A pandemic of influenza was prevalent at that point of time. So the Arbolic Smoke Ball Company is the name of company who have certain amount of medical prescription of sort of an inhaler which was made so that it prevents you from getting influenza or even suffocation. Even if you get it, you don't suffer from influenza. So there was a guarantee by them. They even they said that anybody uses ours, and if they get sick or they get ill because of this influenza, they are willing to compensate them the amount. They even deposited some amount in the bank to convince the public that they are very serious about what they are talking or campaigning. But when a lady called Carlin used this and she got sick within 2 weeks, 3 weeks, she got influenza. So the company denied giving them, saying that you may not have followed some precautions, what we have advised and all that. So she had all documentary evidence and proof also for having followed all the instructions given by the company. So she took them to court. So the court was, after deliberating, it said it is merely an invitation to treat. Is it an invitation to treat? That's what they said. Invitation to treat is something where we only give an information and we impose some sort of a confidence in our customer. But it is not that we are really very serious about what we are trying to say. It's like we see in advertisements. Many of our advertisements are false. They give very false promises of great health and great times by using their products, and you know many a times it's never compensated the way they exhibit in their advertisements. So a public advertisement made in true earnestness is an offer. It's not just an information. This is what the court had taken a ruling, because you have also deposited money, you have told the terms and conditions, everything is very clear, and the customer knows she has not told you it directly, but she has been a party to your terms and conditions and offer. So it is called a public offer, and it is part of your responsibility to compensate them. So when compared with sincerity by a customer, it concludes a legal contract. That's the conclusion. How is a quotation an offer? A price quotation. If you go to the market and take a quotation, is it an offer? Many a times it is not an offer. We'll see how and why. Harvey versus Farse. There was a plot, a very valuable prime plot in a prime location. So Harvey says that this happened in Jamaica in 1893. Will you sell us this bumper hall pen? Then that is the plot. He asked them, and he sends a telegram. Lowest cash price. That is, tell me that what is your price. And answer paid means if you send me a telegram, the telegram charges will be borne by me. This was the old practice which used to happen. So the Farse people communicate to the fellow in the telegram saying the lowest price for ball pen is for the plot is £900. So this fellow thinks that his contract is concluded. So he says, we agree to buy your ball pen for the sum of £900 asked by you. Please send us your title deed in order that we may get the early possession. This is the communication. Now the situation is whether the contract has been concluded or not. So the Harvey people said that no, it is. I mean the Farse people said no, it's not a contract. We cannot sell it to him. They got possibly better prices than 900, so they had sold it off. So there was a dispute in the case. So the court had to say, this is an invitation to treat or is it an offer? Here there was only mere exchange of information and no contract has come into existence. How? Because the question is, will you sell the policy? There has been no reply that we will sell. But they only asked them for the lowest price and he said the lowest price is 900 pounds. But they have not confirmed as such that we are willing to sell you the thing. And he merely takes it for granted that the offer has been made and he is accepting the offer. And so he has gone ahead without an offer. He is just going ahead saying that your offer is accepted. So this is not a full contract. It was supposed to be only a quotation. Will a display of a product in the window with a price tag, will it tantamount to your offer compulsorily? So this is the question. This is the case in around 1959 when Fisher and Bell, there was a display of a flip knife, you know, a small handy knife, which is very convenient, with a price tag sold. The local policeman, when he saw this, he arrested the shopkeeper saying that under the restrictions of Offensive Weapons Act, you are displaying and trying to sell a knife to the public without any permission or sanction. Where goods are displayed in a shop together with the price label, such display is treated as an invitation for trade by the seller and it is not an offer. Please remember, such a situation is not an offer. So he was not actually offering the knife for sale. The sale will tantamount only at a later stage when there are certain developments. What are the developments? The offer is instead made when the customer presents the item to the cashier together with the payment. Simply presenting to the cashier also, it does not become an offer. And even giving a payment on the table, keeping the payment on the table with the product is also not an offer. It's only an offer, I'm sorry. Only then it becomes an offer. It is not a contract. Acceptance occurs at the point when the cashier takes the payment. So when the cashier takes the payment, we can treat it as the contract has been concluded and it becomes legally enforced in law. Of course, the side issue was that whether it is an Offensive Weapons Act non-compliance, the act was later amended that even exposure or possession of knives, such knives will become restrictive. So later on only these were added. So before these were added, the case was deemed acceptance. And it was not a case of deemed acceptance and we had to, it was not a contract. Counter offers are a very important aspect where disputes can happen. When we float tenders, we get offers. And once we get offers, we send letter of intents or we send a contract. Many a times you will see that the terms and conditions, there are certain minor variations between the terms and conditions. Maybe the tender conditions or something, maybe the offer had certain small minor variations or changes, and LOA was not fully 100% complying with the offer. So there could be a lot of differences. Many a times we take it for granted, but it can lead to disputes and lot of problems there. Here is a case of Hyde and Wrench, where an acceptance of an counter offer was the issue. The offer was to sell a form for $1,200. They bargained. The seller says, okay, my final price is $1,000. Then the firm, the Hyde, gives a counter offer of $950. So basically, he has not accepted, but he has given a counter offer. Whereas the original fellow says that he is agreeing only for $1,000 and not for $950. So the sale is refused. But he takes him for court because when you have agreed for selling for $1,000, I have given a counter offer of $950. So the counter offer does not have any sanctity till it is once again accepted. It's not complete acceptance of the offer. So a counter offer after an offer cancels the original offer cannot be treated as a contract concluded. It's once again a fresh offer. So an offer once rejected needs to be revived, like a validity date, you know, beyond the date of validity. You cannot really accept it unless the offer is a validity exception is given. The same way, if the original offer has been challenged by a counter offer, so it is again a new offer and once again the new offer and acceptance cycle starts. So a detailed contract document could have some deviations to the original with what I was telling you, which could make it into a counter offer. When a detailed contract document is finalized based on bid, it's better to have an unambiguous acceptance by the bidder. So all the time what we should do is when a counter offer, or even if you feel that it may not be a counter offer but you are complete, but it's always safe to take an unconditional acceptance from the other side so that the contract is concluded. We we are talking of domestic agreements, can a promise between a married parties result in legally binding agreement? There is a case of Balfour versus Balfour. These are all very popular, popularly discussed in law school cases even today. So that's the reason I am highlighting with these cases, because after this, there are no more cases based on these, only the decisions have been taken on the courts. So Mrs. and Mr. Balfour, they were married for many years, and Mr. Balfour got a job in Sri Lanka. So he promises the wife, because she was not wanting to go to Sri Lanka, so the husband promised to pay wife at £30 per month as allowance to take care of her requirements in England. But later on what happened, this fellow forgets her, he marries a local lady or another partner there in Sri Lanka, and he stops giving the payments to her. So she sues him in the court at England. Court held that there is a rebuttal presumption against an intention to create legally enforceable agreement when the agreement is in domestic in nature. Basically, it means that this is not a contract. Basically, the husband had made a promise which is not enforceable in law, because it has got a technical feature called rebuttal presumption. The feature is that at any point of time, it can be challenged. So to that extent, unless the proof is solid, the cases cannot be dealt in court. In fact, for example, a defendant in a criminal case is presumed innocent until proven guilty. So this is a typical case of rebuttal presumption. And the court also said that domestic commitments were not within the jurisdiction of contract law, and a passing remark which has a sense of humor in that is that contracts will not be sufficient if they are, courts will not be sufficient if they become contracts, because there will always be so many litigations and arguments and failures in domestic commitments. Courts cannot deal with and in so many cases. So that's what they were trying to say. So parties did not intend to be legally bound. That is not a legal promise. Communication of offer or a valid acceptance is necessary. Here's a case of a Lakshman Shukla versus Gauri Dutt. The nephew was missing. Gauri Dutt's nephew was missing. She had a servant, a bungalow pupil called Lalman Shukla. So she sent him, and this fellow was a very mischievous nephew. So it was very difficult to, she was having difficulty in finding him. In fact, he had gone all the way to Rishikesh from Allahabad. The case happened in Allahabad, and he had gone off to Panipat Rishikesh. So she had a doubt. So she sent her Shukla Pune to Allahabad, giving him all the required expenses, money and other things. But in the meanwhile, since it was taking more than 1 or 2 days, she also made pamphlets, flyers, advertising that she will give a reward to the people who find her nephew with a photograph. Now this fellow finds that pamphlet there, and he also happens to find his nephew. He brings the nephew and he demands for the reward. But she refuses to give the reward to him. So he takes up the court. So the court says that the servant was already on job, so he is not entitled to the reward. Though it is a public offer, he is not a party to the public offer. Performance of a condition of proposal is an acceptance of proposal. So basically what the servant deemed is that you have advertised in the newspaper or in the pamphlet, and I have executed, I have performed the contract. It is a condition by itself. So it is true. Many a time performance of condition is a complete satisfactory acceptance of an offer, but not in this case as per the court rulings. There must be an acceptance of offer in order to convert it into a contract, and assent is the basic essential in order to constitute a valid contract. Knowledge and assent, both are important. He was not in the knowledge of this deal which Gauri Dutt had made a public offer. She has not shared it personally with him, nor he has been informed about it. And even if it comes to information, he had already given certain instructions which cannot be overruled. So, the principle of valid acceptance, that is, as per the Indian Contract Act, it should be offered. So, where was the offer? How was the acceptance made here? The fellow was already in subsisting obligations to perform, so there cannot be any consideration for the claim. This was the court ruling. Case of doctrine of frustration. This is another legal term. Whether they are an implied condition to the contract. Whether doctrine of frustration is an implied condition. Here is a case of Grell versus Henry. It is a case where a king was to be coronated, and before coronation they go in for a procession. This happened in 1903. So this fellow was interested in seeing the king's coronation procession. So Henry was a guy who had an apartment on the main road. So this fellow takes it for rent for two days. unfortunately, the coronation was cancelled afterwards, even though he paid the advance. So he came to collect the advance. Henry did not give the advance back, and he was also Utah telling him that you have to take the house for 2 days. You have to pay the balance amount. So there was a claim from both sides, one for refund and one for payment of the balance amount for 2 days. They had to go to court. It was held that it could be incurred from the circumstances surrounding the contract, what the implied purpose behind the contract was. So basically, everybody knows the purpose of the rental agreement was for to attend the coronation. Since the coronation was cancelled, it was beyond the beyond the scope of the party to get it executed or to comply with it. The defendant's purpose of entering into the contract was to view the coronation of the king, and we got frustrated, it got cancelled. So claim for full rent and claim for refund of the thing, both were rejected by the court under the doctrine of frustration. It has been introduced in our Indian Contract Acts also. Any act which was to be performed after the contract is made becomes unlawful, or it is impossible to perform, and which the promisor could not prevent, though he would have loved to have it, then such an act which becomes impossible or unlawful will become a void. Not fault of either parties here. So both are equally not liable for any charges or penalties. It can be treated as an act of God. It can come under force major clause. We all know in this pandemic season, lot of parties are having problems with their contracts. So one has to be very, very liberal in understanding this type of doctrine of frustration. If you go to court and it becomes law of natural justice, many times it may fail. Though we insist that force major clause has to be a part of the contract. Otherwise, we will not go for doctrine of frustration. This is how the stand of railways has been, but it has not yet been tested the waters. If it goes to court, the court can take any decision based on doctrine of frustration. So it becomes a voidable contract. What is a voidable contract? We will see. But GCs of a contract, as I have told, the capacity has to be properly assessed for both the parties, eligibility criteria, the capability, the qualifications, these things have to be thoroughly studied. Then what is the consideration for the contract has to be analyzed, terms and conditions has to be well documented, and there should be consent on both the parties. So these three C's are very important, and they are all large arena for disputes. An offer is a promise in exchange for performance by another party, when responded by an offering. It can be revoked or terminated under certain conditions. So this is another situation wherein the contracts can be terminated even prematurely, but for which proper termination clauses have to be mentioned in the contract. The offers can be of letter form, it can be on websites, it can be through advertisements, or even through implied behavior. Like for example, in auctions, in auction sale, you know very well, the participants will give their offers by mouth, and the person who is conducting the auction has a hammer and he bangs it 3 times. Now how does he know when to bang? So whoever has given an implied offer by the raising of his hand or by the signs of acceptance, and once the hammer goes, the contract is concluded. It shall be within a reasonable time limit. There cannot be endless thing. All contract offers should have a proper time limit, and the validity of its acceptance should be before the validity. Death or insanity of either party or consideration becomes infectious, then the validity of the offer gets invalidated. There is a lot of confusion between estimates, proposals, quotations, bids and tenders. Estimates are not offers, proposals are not offers. Quotations, as I have told you, it may not be an offer. Basically, these are all informations mostly, and based on these informations, when we put it like in a tender document, when we float tenders, we are giving information to the bidders. Then we expect the bidders to bid. The bids become offers and not the tenders. So the bids become offers, and once the offers are accepted, then only the contract is concluded. Acceptance should be communicated properly. Here's a case of Fenghouse versus Bindley, a nephew's horse. That is Fenghouse had a nephew who had certain farmhouse with certain horses. Fenghouse came and saw one of his nephew's horses, and he said that he loves this horse. So anyway, his nephew was planning to sell off his farm through Bindley. Bindley was his intermediary who was to sell the property. So before he offers all the land and horses to him, property to him, Feldhaus says that he does his debut, his interest to buy the horse, and he further says that if I hear no more about him, I consider this horse mine for 30.15 pounds, that is 15 shillings. This is what Feldhaus told to his nephew. But the nephew forgets to tell Bindley about this horse. Of course, even his nephew was undecided whether to sell it off or not. But not to sell. He was decided not to sell it, but he may not have been sure about having it or selling it to his uncle or not. So to that extent, he informs Bindley not to sell the horse. But by mistake, Bindley, along with all the horses and all the farm property, he sells off the entire property. And then Feldhaus becomes very upset and he sues this fellow that that horse actually belonged to me because he had already given an offer to his nephew, and the nephew was silent about it. And silence means acceptance. Maunam Samartham is what we generally understand. So he feels that the horse actually belonged to him. Only the quantity transaction was pending, but the ownership has already been taken. And this fellow Bindley has sold his property. So he sued him under the torts of conversion clause. But the nephew had never communicated his clear acceptance to the uncle's offer. And Bindley was nowhere in the picture, understanding what was happening about the whole thing. So the court had a ruling which said that one cannot impose an obligation on another to accept an offer. Basically, the uncle was trying to dominate over the nephew and trying to say that this horse is mine and I am going to accept it and I'll pay you this much for it. And he, without trying to get any clear acceptance from the nephew, he just vanishes off. So court said that silence cannot amount to acceptance. The uncle had no right to impose a sale through silence, whereby the contract could only fail by repudiation. This is another legal term. Failing by repudiation is that rejection for the proposal is still open to the nephew. It was not yet decided whether he is going to accept it or reject it. So this is failing on the clause of repudiation. Acceptance must be communicated clearly. Feldhaus did not own the horse and there was no clear acceptance for the contract to have been concluded, which made anything of his, gave any rights to the uncle. So, with these examples, I hope you have got some picture about what are the grey areas in contracts. A small value contract doesn't matter much, but when it becomes a big value contract, and many times agreements between neighbors, agreements between the family members, also need to go into legal framework. Otherwise, taken for granted can lead to complications. So it's good to have certain ideas about this offer and acceptance of a contract. You look into contract management in the legal ahead. Before that, I just wanted to bring to your notice certain features where this type of problems can happen. Not whenever you see any clauses with the word notwithstanding or here and there, these are very dangerous words and can encompass many issues which can be written in fine print, may not be known to the person who is participating in the tender. So it may have special terms and conditions. There can be conditions in enclosures which may not be read through, and later on when there are disputes can come to light and can come as big shocks and can lead to huge losses also. It may have a lot of financial repercussions. Similarly, intellectual property clauses need to be introduced or read properly. Otherwise, these can also lead to complications, especially nowadays. Lot of intellectual properties India is very weak about, and day by day lot of stress is being given on intellectual property. So, and many of our activities or technical activities, lot of technical features are available in our terms and conditions, and we would not like our competitors to or the general public to know about the internal trade secrets. So intellectual property clauses are very important before you conclude a contract. Last minute divisions. They may have some shocking inclusion. Generally, this cut-based concept, we float tenders. Before floating tenders, a lot of changes are made. We don't know which version of the draft copy has been introduced into the final tender documents. And similarly, when the bidders also can go into some new versions, or they may put in some shocking inclusions. By mistake, something can get copy-pasted and something can go away. So it can lead to a lot of complications. So one has to be careful about them. Automatic renewal clauses, these are also there. And many of these automatic renewal clauses with huge penalties in case they are not timely supported can also lead to certain sort of disputes. Financial obligations can be the fine print, which I have already told you. Forum selection clauses. These financial obligations in the fine print is becomes even more important, especially in our day-to-day working. On internet, we do a lot of financial transactions, and in a very fine print, a small box for a tick mark comes. I read the terms and conditions, and you just in the hurry, we simply tick it, saying that what would be there. But many times you can be you should be careful, because this can be monopolistic terms and conditions. And as long as things are going normal, there should be no problem. But once you get into complications, there could be huge implications. So this is another important area where the fine print has to be read, especially when there are big contracts. Forum selection process, especially for dispute resolution, many a times thought process is not gone into that. Luckily, we now have consumer international forums are available, even if it is not well decided. But still, in institutional contracts, this type of dispute resolutions have to be well documented. We have seen a lot of cases wherein forum redressal clauses say that we should go for arbitration before they go to court. But still, some of the suppliers go to court, and they are compelled to go for arbitration. But sometimes what happens is the court itself decides who the arbitrator is. So there can be a dispute which we can also argue against, that court has no right to decide on the arbitrator as per the latest arbitration process. So it can be a dispute area where one has to be very careful. Foreign laws, when you deal with foreign parties, especially today, we do a lot of internet transactions and internet contracts involving foreign parties where we may not even know their origins, we may not know anything much about them, but we have faith by their brand names, and then there could be complications. One should understand which country you are dealing, what are their foreign laws, and in case of any problems, it could be very serious. It could also lead to criminal cases wherein you may have problems. Admin clauses or discussions on authorities, generally monopolistic clauses are available, you know, in our railway system or government contracts. Lot of admin clauses is there. It will be at the pleasure of the general manager that decides. For example, our arbitration clauses says very clearly that the arbitrator will be decided by the general manager. Many a time this is argued. How can a general manager of a railway, whose interest is one of the parties, the interested party, how he can decide the arbitrator? So these are all some of the admin clauses that we have incorporated in the contract. As I was telling you, many of the contracts can become voidable. They may not be a void contract at the time of concluding, but in the future they could become void. How is it possible? A voidable contract is one that is valid under law and still enforceable if both parties agree to it, but contains some elements which lead to it becoming unforceable. If a contract was signed under duress, as we know, if it is, that is the capacity of the party signing is not in the fairness, non-fairness. The mental state may not be proper, then it is not legal. One of the parties may be hiding certain material facts, very important facts may have been hidden, and later on it comes to light, it can be challenged in court. There could be some mistakes or misrepresentations of facts which make them voidable. So such type of breach of contract can be challenged and disputed. Now we will come to the most important aspect of contract management. Today the contracts are becoming very, very complicated day by day. And one thing on what we should remember is change is inevitable. Many of the times the contracts are long enough that lot of changes happen in the scenario of execution. So change is constant and change is inevitable. So contract is also for a change, in fact, because anything that you contract is for some new development. And whenever new development happens, it is a change situation. So in fact, a contract itself is for a change. And change management contract management is also part of the change management. And change management itself is a subject, is a vast subject one should understand and appreciate. What are the stages of contract management? Initial request, that is when the bids are, tenders are floated, when the needs are assessed, when the expectations are communicated to the contracting bodies, or what are the risks associated have to be evaluated, understood, appreciated. So, at the stage of initial request, one has to consider all the various aspects that are going into the procurement process. So this is a very important stage. Authoring contracts, so a good drafting skills are required for floating of tenders and contract or document preparation. Many a times, many institutions, these are all very standardized. Tender documents are there, standardized contract documents, purchase order documents are standardized. So that makes things more easier, because there are a lot of legal aspects associated with this. So whenever legal aspects are associated, the legal skills are important, and experience in the core areas are also important. So authoring the contracts is an expertise or a skill area which one has to develop or understand. Negotiating the contract, so the process of moving forward from the offer to the acceptance to the contract documentation, it is a process sailing through, wherein it has to involve transparency and a huge amount of trust. Now the days of past, when things were taken for granted of monopolistic understanding, today if the customers have become wiser, the bidders are becoming wiser and more demanding, so we cannot be taken for granted. Approving the contract, you know the process of vetting and concurrence is there in our labor procedures. Same has to happen even in other industry situations. There are schedule of hours. We have the canons of financial prudency to be looked into, the correctness of the documents that are going into the formation of the contract, the parties involved in the contract, for the sole parties, you know, many a times the bidders give authorizations to third party to participate in the tender or to collect the materials in sale of scrap. So one has to see those points before the contract is approved. Whether there is an amount of expertise involved in finalization of contracts. That's how we have a purchase department, a procurement department, very wisely decided by Housewell here. Sisters of ours in the railway system, many of the organizations don't even have procurement organizations separately under them. They still do, whereas it is not a very proper thing because it has become a very highly specialized area. And contract management and supply chain management is a subject by itself. So the skill area and the expertise need to be continued. Executing the contract, this is the long term phase when the contracts get executed. E-signatures have to be involved. Authorities who can take the decisions, and authorities who can execute the contract, who are the signatories to the parties to the decision making at all levels. You know, there will be supervisory level, there will be managerial level, there will be corporate level, and same company, but there will be various levels of operation going on in the contract execution. So at each stage, there are certain obligations and certain duties on both the sides. So this obligation management is a very, very important aspect, wherein compliance review has to be monitored at a very regular level. Otherwise, it could lead to cost and time overruns and serious repercussions at a later date. And as time passes, there will be need for revisions and amendments, especially the change of regulations can happen. There can be variations in requirements. So these type of variations management is an expertise by itself. So it's important that you have a dedicated contract management force. Of course, other areas is auditing and reporting. There are milestones which are set. There can be internal audit by your local managers, by the corporate managers. They can monitor the milestones and see how good the contract is moving or progressing or is expected to progress in the near future and take corrective actions for that. And many times, renewal. What happens if we expire, renewal schedules expire, how do we renew them, whether it is with penalty, without penalty, or it is a defixation of delivery periods, is it staggered deliveries to be taken, or the funds provided, which are originally thought of, are they available, because many of the cost overruns, there can be shortage of money and the contract not seen. So when we renew the contract to the contractors, even the contractors have to be worried about the financial situation of the client. So this is what the contract management team can always prompt just before the expiry of the terms and time schedules. So what is the objectives of the contract management? The purpose of contract management is to ensure that all the parties of the contract fully meet their respective obligations as efficiently and effectively as possible. See, this is a very, very big dispute area where lot of care and thought process has to go in, including control and monitoring processes. Deliver the business and operational outputs required from the contract. So many a times the client always keeps on changing with variations, their requirements keep changing. It may be possible within the terms of the contract, it may not be possible within the terms of the contract. It may be at the discretion of the contractor who is executing the contract, what are the outputs that he is planned for or he is capable of doing within the scope of the contract. So all these things have to be deliberated and thought of, and accordingly actions have to be taken, whether contract amendments have to be issued or any other financial aspects have to be issued. Many times there can be price variation clauses, statutory variation clauses already available. Whether they may be sufficient, they may not be sufficient, these things can always lead to disputes. The formula that are being adopted for this price variation clauses also become very, very important. One has to see for value for money, accountability and outcome-based reporting has to be part. So all these things are in the scope of contract management. We are a very specialist organization who have a lot of experience in the core activities, in management of contracts, in management of suppliers and vendors, in management of legal aspects of the contract. So there are various aspects in following it up. 4C and abate. Risks. Risk management has become a very, very big subject in management nowadays. So, as an, from the stage of initiating the procurement process, one has to assess the risk right through till the end. And even post-contract stage also, the risks have to be assessed. It is always wise to have proper record keeping done at various stages.
रमेश कुमार मान लीजिए जानकारी नहीं था एग्जीक्यूटिव में उद्देश्य कर अब उसका पत्नी के नाम से मैंने पे ऑर्डर बना के बनाना चाह रहा है तो सिस्टम में वो हटेगा रमेश कुमार को हटा के हम उसका पत्नी सिस्टम तो सीआईपी तो रमेश कुमार के नाम से निकला हुआ है नाम तो हाइड है उसको चेंज नहीं कर सकते
रिटर्न चेक हुआ
क्या
सीआईपी
सर्टिफिकेट तो हमारा रमेश कुमार दिखा रहा
है and later on there could be
some
so it's better to have a proper documentation scheme which would be a contract management team who are experts in the field can ensure on a continuous continuum things are going in a proper manner protect the rights of all the parties each party has their own rights by way of the contract and even by way of regulations many a times regulations may not be part of the contract but they are compulsory to be complied with the law of the land
pass to kar rahi nahi
hai or in the local region local rules they have to be complied with you have no escape pollution control boards are available the parking spots are rights but here it is not part of the contract it could be other stakeholders who are also impacted or affected by the contract so they can also have rights against any of the parties to challenge in court
हमारा सिस्टम में रमेश कुमार दिखा रहा है
so one has to be prepared for this also here also an expertise by the contract management team
नीचे कैसे रिटर्न हो
रहा
है तो हमारे सिस्टम में ऑटोमेटिक आ जाएगा लेकिन हम सीआईपी संकल्प को हम रिटर्न नहीं कर सकते उसमें सेव करने का ऑप्शन है बैक टू मेनू करने का ऑप्शन है बस आप हम मंथन बहुत किए हैं बहुत मंथन किए नहीं हो पाएगा
newly introduced ISO systems like the EMS, UMS, so TQM, so many activities. Then we have the senior management executives or the leads who are the like our J-grade officers who are supposed to be the engines of our activities, because the people above J-grade generally are the decision makers, policy makers, and also they are monitors, guiders. That's all. But actual work is done, monitored performances greatly goes towards the senior management people, and then ultimately we have the staff who are the permanent staff. But again, this full diamond is supported by third party providers. Lot of our activities, non-core activities are now getting outsourced. So there are lot of other players coming into our jobs now. Day in and day out, we are seeing many such new third parties coming in. So you get the documentation to various works is through third parties. So for now the situation is getting complicated, and lot of contracts are getting executed day in day out, and not only purchase of goods, lot of services and works which were hitherto done locally. Even goods also, we used to do shop manufacture, local manufacture. In fact, today if you go to the production units, majority of our manufacturing activities are being outsourced now, and only assemblies of many of our production units are going towards only assembly units rather than production activities. So the many contracts are of various complicated nature. Long term contracts are also coming in today. So these things have to have some special contractual requirements and conditions which are getting very complicated. Hence, the scenarios are changing. There is a huge paradigm shift. Hence, it is always advisable to have a professional team going for contract management. So, what are the roles of the contract management? The controlling role, they ensure the performance in the KPI reporting is going on, where the weak areas, key performance indices are monitored, and wherever deviations or problems are there, they can be flagged, and attention to the right location, to the right personnel, to the right system can be signaled for precautions and changes. Care on finances, basically today the financial resources have become very tight, the budgets are very tight, payments are very quick on the system, so errors should not happen, funds should be available, system should function properly, there cannot be time and cost overruns. So these have to be well managed by the contract management team. Documentation reporting, I have told, audit trails. There should be enough support system to understand at what stage the audits have happened and what who is responsible, how to fix responsibility, who is the authority, whether the right authority has taken the appropriate decision or not. When we look back, this becomes important and imperative. Monitor compliance of parties. This is the regular monitoring and control. This is the important aspect of contract management. Now comes the interaction, which we are all very, very, very weak in our government organizations. We have to invest in relationships, especially with supplier relationship management and also with vendors representatives at all levels, top management, middle management, lower management levels. Right now, it is more of a domination by the user, by the government organization. We treat our vendors very badly. There is no mature understanding. There is no between understanding. So and with this change scenario, things have become very complicated. So the relationship should be very important. Orchestrate the network. The networks have become so complicated. So many representatives are there at various places. So many authorizations are there. So many backward integration and forward integrations are happening. So the network is very large. So how to go through the network process within the contractual framework so that it can be legally viable, all the actions and decisions and communications are legally imposed. So this aspect is also very, very important, for which lot of interactions are required at various levels, and documentation has to be prepared, and a smooth sailing has to happen. So the more important nowadays is the claims and disputes, the courts and the arbitrations and the dispute resolution becoming more modern, more quicker, and more better system being available. The claims and disputes are also on the increase. So many of these disputes and claims can be resolved through proper relationships and proper interaction rather than going to the third party dispute resolution. Adaptability is very important. Comprehend issues on hand, what are the risks associated with your plan, and the organization and the teamwork should be adaptable. Changes are coming very fast. Now we have seen there are various types of joint ventures coming up. There are a lot of vehicles which are new types of contracts. Triple P is coming up. So a lot of contracts are coming up. Same teams are used, same managers are used. they should know very fast how to adapt to the new environment for identification, prioritization of their activities and various aspects of the contract. Variations management, I have spoken enough about it. Plans, planning, assess the demand and supply, market intelligence, continual improvement over the, all the activities. These are all important. And ultimately, everything is getting digitalized. Artificial intelligence is coming up. Even for contract management, we can now use artificial intelligence. So even contract management has got computerized. There are a lot of softwares nowadays being developed and evolved. And contract lifecycle, contract management is new software solutions which are coming up, which can be used in view. So this is the figure as far as the relationships are concerned. Till now we have been only bothering about what is visible to us, that is contractual documents, and there are two separate entities. We know each other parties, and we think we can communicate with the minimum communication, we can execute the contract. Unfortunately, today the scenario is further. It's only a tip of the iceberg. The internal values and attitudes which have to be pursued in the contract management, they are more difficult to be observed. These are not visible, they are not so easy. What are they? They are all deep drivers of behaviors. Lot of maturity and clarity is required in the top management, especially for having a proper management system, which is having a proper communication orientation, conflict resolute orientation, relationship orientation, strategic orientation, and value orientation. So these are all the various things. Each can be a session by itself. There are a lot of modern techniques and modern strategies which are available, which we need to follow and abide with. There is a lot of maturity in the vendors. Many of our vendors and parties are becoming world class in nature. They are also having a lot of such professional teams with them. So we should also be confident to face them as and when the need arises. So I am done with this session basically. If you have time for question answers, probably some people can ask some questions. I think some things are there in the charts.
Participants can unmute themselves and ask questions if any.
Yeah, I will just continue before we go to the next phase. Small, another 15 minutes, I will discuss this.
Okay,
in the meanwhile, people can ask questions.
Okay.
Because I was a bit fast in the whole session.
Yes, sir.
So most of them are known, but then I am touching the soft corners of the contract management to ensure that everybody has clarity on that. Now, what is this standard form of contract? Standard form of contract is contract adhesion. You know, contract of adhesion. Basically, in big organizations like railways, insurance companies, and other organizations, they have their own standard printed terms and conditions. So, there is hardly any scope to deviate from those terms and conditions. It is either you take it or you leave it, one of the two. So, that's the reason they ask a small tick in the, towards the end of the, before you submit your offer. They say, I accept all terms and conditions. There's only a tick there. If you press the blue portion of the terms and conditions, you will get to, you will go to some 10 pages of very fine print, which you may not even be patient enough to read all those things. So this is a standard form of contract. They usually better have a pre-printed and they are pre-drawn. The conditions and terms of conditions are all well established. Basically, the reason is that these are all of very legal consequences. The terms and conditions have to be very well drafted. Every comma and a full stop becomes very, very important, and hence these are well drafted terms and conditions. But we will see the disadvantages as we see go ahead. The other party has little or no ability to negotiate more favorable terms. This is becoming an unequal bargaining power. Boilerplate contracts, they promote economic efficiency and useful for training and awareness. So basically the same standard form of contract is also called a boilerplate contract, and the terms and conditions, like we have general conditions of contract, important terms of tender, conditions for tenderers, these are all well drafted boilerplate contracts. They promote us economic of efficiency. How? Because every time you float a tender, you don't have to rethink or reinvite the terms and conditions. You simply attach them and you go ahead. And these are also very good useful training materials to various newcomers to understand what are the terms and conditions of the contract and to make them available to themselves. There is also standard form of contracts which are rarely read, and many are unconscionable and also unquestionable. Majority of the important terms and conditions are monopolistic in nature, some of them. So they have very little scope, and when it comes to dispute, we ourselves can understand the parties are in a very unfortunate situation. So these standard forms of contract is now slowly becoming infamous because of these unconscionable and unequitable terms and conditions. So they may not stand the court of law when we go to court many a time, because they don't comply with the natural justice. Access to the full terms and the contract may be difficult, or it is impossible before acceptance. As I have told you, you don't have that much time to understand and read the terms and conditions. So it becomes very, very drudgery to read them, which will not fit you a lot. So this is a disadvantage to the smaller party and an advantage to the bigger party. The standard forms of contract may exploit unequal power relations. So it is better to go for bespoke contracts as an alternative. Bespoke contract or one-time contracts where new terms and conditions are imposed totally afresh. They are called greenfield contracts or bespoke contracts. But one idea of this bespoke contracts alternate can be the combination of bespoke and standard forms, like what we do in the railways. We have general conditions of contract and important terms of conditions to the tenderers, which are pre-printed, and we just attach them. But we also have some important special terms and conditions in the contracts, and these special terms are modified now and then by introducing the new small changes into the specific cases that are being procured. So there are situations when there can be conflicts. Which is more important? General conditions in standard form of contract cannot be modified, may have a copyright. Basically, like FIDIC has got standard terms and contracts, and they have copyrights. You cannot alter them. But we can modify them in the standard terms and conditions, or called additional data or additional clauses. Here, we impose clause-wise for these clauses, which are numbered so properly, serial numbered in a proper manner, all paragraphs and all conditions are numbered. We can adopt those serial numbers and put in our additional data and modify some conditions in that. We can also incorporate in special or supplementary conditions into the tenders. So there are various types in which these terms and conditions are in various levels. There can be as part B, special provisions. Part A will have standard conditions, part B will have special provisions, and special provisions are changing, varying from contract to contract. So how to know which is the order of preference? Because which one, sometimes these special provisions may overrule the general conditions, or sometimes this may be more stringent than this. Now, which is more important and which has got the overriding factor? There is a rule of law, general rule of law. Special written clauses or document forming the part of a contract will take precedence over the standard conditions or documents. So, for example, if you release a contract agreement or a purchase order, and if we write some special condition which is in variation to the general conditions, then the special conditions has an overriding priority than the general terms and conditions. So the offered terms, which are specially offered and incorporated in the advance letter of acceptance or LOI or in the purchase order, they have an overriding impact. Amendments to contracts can be with mutual consent. We can issue amendments to the contracts as and when we mutually agree that these are possible to be amended. Sometimes amendments can also be within the scope of the original conditions of the contract. Then you don't need mutual consent, but any other variations will require mutual consent. Like I'm talking about 30% option clauses or 25% option clauses, wherein the quantity can be amended. It is already pre-designed in the tender conditions that the employer or the buyer has the powers to increase or decrease the quantity. There, mutual consent is not required, and the contracts can be amended by themselves. But anything other than the original terms and conditions, if there are any variations or amendments, these have to be with mutual consent. And mind you, whatever is amended has an overriding superiority or then that has to be spelled out in the contract in a proper manner, that even though we may make some changes to our offers or the final contract, the original terms and conditions.
It's a 17 number or it's a 18 number? Or 07 number 94?